Good morning and welcome to FirstSF. We are grateful that we get to worship here this Sunday morning. If you're in the foyer or grabbing coffee from one of our lovely youth that serve that every Sunday, you can come find a seat, find your way into the sanctuary. Especially if you're a newcomer and this is your first time, we're just so grateful that you would choose to come worship with us on a Sunday. Whether you are looking for a new church, just in town visiting, or if you're seeking God and discerning what God may have for you in your life, we really hope that you would be able to find that Jesus is the answer to all of our life's yearnings and questions through our Sunday service. And for all of us that are members and here, we always rejoice and get the pleasure to worship together on a Sunday morning. Just want to announce a happy Veterans Day. I know especially for those veterans that may have served in our church, we're grateful for you, and thank you for the day off, but also for more than that. This Sunday, we're also having a children's homily. In our passage, we're going to be looking at how Jesus says, "Let the children come to me." And so in fitting fashion, we're going to ask the children to come to Jesus by coming to Ben at the front of the sanctuary. So if you are an elementary age child, so fifth grade or under, we'd ask that you, during that children's homily, which will be after the very first song, find your way and make your way down to the front for that special time for you, especially if you're sitting up in the they're not bleachers, but the balcony, thank you. Mine's on sports right now. Go Niners. If you're sitting up in the balcony, you can make your way down here. What I always love, too, about the whole idea of the children's homily is, and as we'll see what Jesus says, let the children come to me. It's not just a call for children physically to come to Jesus, but for all those that take the posture of a child, trusting in God as a father, that we have this confidence to draw near to God. Because of Christ, we have this confidence and this joy to see God as a father, regardless of how we've experienced God as a father or parent, or our physical parents or not, we can trust to know that God is a good father, that we have confidence he will always receive our coming. He will always rejoice in us seeking him. And we will always have his love and pleasure over us because of Christ. And so as we start off our service focusing on that, I want to read for us from Hebrews chapter 4, where the writer of Hebrews tells us of this great confidence because of what Jesus has done. "Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." And that's the same call that all those who are in Christ this morning get to rejoice and sing about and get to live out as we come to God this morning with confidence, both for salvation, but also hope and grace in time of need. Let's pray before our God, our Father, this morning. Father, we give you thanks that because of Christ and what he has already done and accomplished on the cross, you invite us, no, you implore us to come and seek you as a father, as your children. Lord, I pray that any of us who may be wondering or doubting your love and goodness over us, that we would look to the cross as a reminder that we have a good father because of Christ, who was the good son and yet gave his life up for us. Lord, I pray that that would instill in us this confidence, not to come of our own self-made confidence, of our own self-assurance, but of an assurance that is bound up, wrapped up in Christ's work for us. Father, may that give us a joy to run to you, God, to see that we have help in the midst of need, to know that we have grace that reigns even over sin, even over our own sin. We have grace that overcomes it. So, Father, as we sing these songs, as we worship you this morning, may we remember the posture of a child that trusts fully in you as our good father and turns our eyes and our hearts heavenward again to find our comfort, solace, and help in you, God. We thank in your son's name. Amen. Would you stand with us as we worship our God, our heavenly father this morning?
Thank you. unless you're elementary age, or even if you happen to be in preschool age kid and you want to come join me down front, it's always nice to not have to sit down here by myself. So if you'd like to come join me, even if you're coming from the balcony, we can wait. But always just appreciate this time. We try to have this time maybe once a month or so to be able to have a time where we focus on the children of our church. Just so excited that they are part of our worship each and every week, but to be able to have a time just to speak directly to kids and to think about what we're talking about as a church today. So mostly just want to preview our sermon and a little bit of what we're going to cover. So today, as Pastor Clark was mentioning in the very beginning, this is a story in which people were trying to bring their children to Jesus. Jesus was probably maybe popular at this time. Maybe there were lots of people around, but some parents thought it was really important that their kids get to Jesus so that he might be able to pray for them. And did you know that some of the people that were around Jesus, even some of Jesus' own followers, thought that Jesus might have been too busy for these children? Has he ever felt like somebody was too busy for you? Maybe you are being ignored only because you were a kid? I can remember that as a kid. Sometimes I felt like certain things I wasn't allowed to do just because I was a kid. Or certain times, adults, maybe just because they were taller than me and they couldn't look me in the eye, it felt like they were always too busy. They always had other things going on. And you know, sometimes even now that I'm an adult, I become guilty of that. There's sometimes when I feel like I have so much work to do, I have so many things that I have to take care of, that my own sons will ask me if I'll play with them, and I'll say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm too busy. Or they'll ask me if I'll read a book to them, and I think I have too many other things to do. But Jesus always had time for kids. I want you to know that Jesus did not see the children as a distraction to what he was supposed to be doing, but he saw the children as what he was supposed to be doing. The time that he had with the kids was so important, and Jesus told the people that they should bring the children to him. I want you to know, just even as you're a kid who's just now growing up, I want you to know that Jesus is real, that he loves you, and that he always has time for you. That even when maybe it feels like other adults, even your own parents, are too busy at times, I want you to know that Jesus, that God, our good Father, always has time for you, that you can go to him, that he loves you, and wants what is best for you. So I want you to know that today as we talk, that you can always go to Jesus because he always has time for you. And then I want you to know one other thing. There's going to be a day when you're no longer a kid. And one day you're going to be a grown-up. And one day you're going to have the chance to tell kids whether or not they are important. I hope that you'll reflect the heart of Jesus. And I hope that you'll continue to trust in him just like you do even as a kid. As Pastor Clark was mentioning as we start the service, the way that Jesus brought children to him was a picture of the ways that we all must come to Jesus, with a dependence upon him, the way that children have in their parents, with a trust in him that sometimes we have easier as kids than we do as adults. And so as you get older and as you get bigger and as you get more important, I hope that you'll always see that Jesus has time for you and that you'll always have the childlike faith, the trust in him that you have maybe even now as a kid. So I want you to be thinking about those things as we read our passage this morning and as we think about who Jesus brings into his kingdom. Okay, would you pray with me as we think about those things and prepare our hearts for studying God's word? Would you pray with us? Father, we thank you for the love that you have for us. We thank you that in your eyes we are each important. No matter how old or young we are, no matter who we are or what we have done, you've made us, you know us, you love us, and you always have time for us. God, I pray that our children and our adults, that all of us will believe that. I pray that as we study your word today, your love would be made even more true, that your trustworthiness would be even more real in our lives. And just as children trust in their parents, just as children are dependent upon others, I pray that each one of us would realize how dependent we are on you and how much you love us and we would continue to trust in you and walk with you and have a relationship with you as our Heavenly Father. God, we thank you for this time that you've given us today. Thank you for your word. As we study it today, would you help us to understand it and to live it out? We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, thank you guys. You can head back to your seat and you all can stand up and we can continue our time of worship.
Thank you.
Would you pray with me? Father, as we come to meet you in your word, I pray that you would help us to fix our eyes on you. God, I pray that as we look into your word, that you would speak to us, that you would help us to see you more clearly. God, I also pray that you would help us to see the things that pull our eyes off of you. God, point out those things in our lives that we trust in more than you. Reveal those idols to us, God. And as you remind us of who you are and of what you've done in our lives, I pray that it would help us to be able to surrender those things that we hold on to, those things that we fix our eyes on, and to trust in you and to walk with you. God, we thank you that your Spirit inspired these words that we read. Thank you that your Spirit has preserved them, that we might now be able to read and hear your word. I pray today, God, that we would truly hear your word. I also pray that by the power of your Spirit, we would not just hear your word, but we'd be able to be doers of your word as well. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you may be seated. And if you have a Bible this morning, I want to invite you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 19. If you brought a Bible, if you have one on your phone, you can turn there. There should also be a Bible in the chair of the pew in front of you. And we're going to be in Matthew chapter 19. We're going to be in the second half of the chapter 19 of Matthew. We're coming back to our study of Matthew's gospel, starting back last week after some time away for a different series. And we're going to be in Matthew's gospel for just this week and then the next couple of weeks. Then we're going to take another break as we come to the season of Advent. But one thing that you're going to see is that today's passage, and for the next 2 weeks, so for the rest of chapter 19, and through really all of chapter 20, there is one overarching theme. It's a theme that we've already seen throughout Matthew's gospel. We've already come across this idea many different times, but it's really clearly here in this chapter and a half. And that theme is that the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven that Jesus has been proclaiming at the beginning of his ministry, the king that he has come to be and the kingdom that he has brought, it is an upside-down kingdom. Probably, it's more likely to say it's the right-side-up kingdom and we're the ones that are upside down. But at least from a worldly perspective, from the point of view that we're used to looking at things, what Jesus does, the kingdom that he brings, really seems to be backwards. It seems to be an upside-down kingdom. That's something that we're going to see all throughout this passage and for the next couple of weeks. And it's so important that we begin to grasp that reality, that the kingdom is upside down, because if we don't understand that, we're never going to be able to enter the kingdom or to live in the kingdom if we're approaching it like we would all the other kingdoms and groups of this world. You see, most of the time when you think about a group in this world, a club, a school, a job, the way that you enter into that group is to prove your worthiness. You know, you have to fill out that application as best as you can, all the sentences just correct, so that they'll accept you. You have to present your resume in the best kind of way forward that would present you as the ideal candidate. And so many times we think that this is the way that we are going to approach the kingdom of God. This is the way that we're going to enter the kingdom of God, by showing our worthiness, why we belong there. Sometimes it's even the case that it's how we think we should continue to live in the kingdom, by proving the fact that we are worthy through the many good things that we do. But the kingdom is actually upside down from what we're used to seeing. It's upside down from the kingdoms of the world. What we'll see today is that to those whom the kingdom belongs are not the ones who can prove their worthiness, but it's actually those who would confess their unworthiness. That those who would be put into a right relationship with God, those who would have salvation, have eternal life with God, are not those who are going to work really hard and earn it, but to those who confess that they can't. That salvation is given not by our merit, but by God's mercy. That we can't attain salvation through our grit and hard work, but it's only by the grace of God. This is what we see all throughout these passages, and especially here today. So Matthew chapter 19, We're going to start reading in verse 13, and we're going to go to the end of the chapter, which is verse 30. Matthew tells us, "Then children were brought to him," meaning Jesus, "that he might lay his hands on them and pray. And the disciples rebuked the people. But Jesus said, 'Let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven.' And he laid his hands on them, and they went away. And behold, a man came up to him, saying, 'Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life?' And he said to him, 'Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you would enter life, keep the commandments.' And he said to him, 'Which ones?' And Jesus said, 'You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself.' The young man said to him, 'All these I have kept. What do I still lack?' And Jesus said to him, 'If you would be perfect, go, sell what you have, what you possess, and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me.' When the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And Jesus said to his disciples, 'Truly, I say to you, only with difficulty will a rich person enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God.' When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished, saying, 'Who then can be saved?' But Jesus looked at them and said, 'With man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible.' Then Peter said in reply, 'See, we have left everything and followed you. What then will we have?' Jesus said to him, 'Truly I say to you, in the new world, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or lands for my name's sake will receive 100-fold and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first.'" Now, if you just follow the passage as Matthew's written it for us, what we have is we have two, you could say, groups of people that come to Jesus. One's really a group of people and one's one man, but kind of two representative examples, if you will, of the way people are coming to Jesus. And then from there, Jesus uses these two examples to have this dialogue, this teaching time with his disciples to reveal to them some important truths about the kingdom of heaven, this upside-down kingdom. So that's kind of how I want us to follow along with Matthew today. I want you to notice that there's these two examples, two real-life case studies, two that I think are put together for a reason, that I think God had them come together in this way and that Matthew recorded them for a reason, that they would set up a really great contrast for us. And these two examples then lead to three important truths about the kingdom that I think we need to hear if we're going to view the kingdom in the right way. So first, our two examples. The first example comes to us in these children that are brought to Jesus. And so here's the way I would summarize the first example for you. One group came with nothing to offer, and they trusted in Jesus. The first example that we see is a group that comes to Jesus with nothing really to give him, really only to ask something from him. Now, you might remember, it's been a little while since we took that break and did our Explore God series, but you might remember all the way back to Matthew chapter 18, there was a time when Jesus invited a child to come to him, right? And he held this child up as an example of one who is going to be greatest in the kingdom. So this time, it's not that Jesus is bringing up a child, but rather children are being brought to him. So we see it in verse 13. It says, "Then children were brought to him that he might lay his hands on them and pray." And this is probably pretty common in the Jewish culture of the day. It's probably common that people would want to take their children to maybe a rabbi, maybe to a prophet, to a religious leader, and hope that he would lay his hands on them and pray for them, that they might be blessed. So we don't know exactly what these parents, those who were bringing the children, thought of Jesus. We're not told that they thought he was the Messiah necessarily, but they certainly didn't think what some of the other religious leaders had been saying at this point. This man has a demon. Well, this man is a false prophet. He's doing things that don't please God. He's breaking all the laws. They obviously didn't think that. They thought that Jesus was a man of God. Such a man of God that they would want their children to come to him and him to take the time to lay his hands on them and pray for them. But notice at the end of verse 13, it says, the disciples rebuked the people. Parents are bringing their children to Jesus, and the disciples begin to rebuke them, correct them, stop them. Now, why would the disciples do this? Well, I guess we'd have to think that they probably thought that maybe Jesus was too busy. They probably thought that these children were a distraction from the real ministry. Kind of thought that these children maybe were a bit of a nuisance. Children were to be avoided. I mean, who knew that the disciples were from San Francisco? Oh, some of you don't like that joke. Okay, you've never had kids in our city, maybe. Okay. Listen to how Jesus responds. But Jesus said, let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven. Verse 15, and he laid his hands on them and went away. Now, it is clear here that Jesus is using children as an example, as an illustration. You'll notice at the end of verse 14, he says, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven. Something that he had already begun to teach and illustrate back in chapter 18, but that those who are going to come to the kingdom, to those whom the kingdom is going to belong, are those who are going to come humbly, those who are going to come dependent. Like children, he is saying, these are the ones who are going to receive, who are going to be welcomed into my kingdom. And so I would say if there is a main application for us here, it is that we would come to Jesus like children. We would come like this group, recognizing that we have nothing to offer and that we are totally dependent upon Jesus. It would seem to be that that's Jesus' kind of main point as he says, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven. But at the same time, I do want to point out to you that Jesus doesn't just use children as an example here, an illustration, but he actually does take the time to minister to them. And it wasn't he was just doing this for a show or for a metaphor, but he actually took the time to lay his hands on the children. He actually took the time to minister to them. And so from that, I do want to draw out a few, maybe you could call them pastoral applications for us today. So first of all, if you're here today and you are a parent, maybe a parent of a young child, a teenager, I just want to say thank you for bringing your children to church. In a similar way, as these parents were trying to get their children to Jesus, in many ways, that is what you are doing as a Christian parent. You're doing your best to bring your children to Jesus. And I know that that's not always an easy thing to do. I mean, sometimes just getting to church is quite the ordeal. Whether they're young kids and you've got to get them dressed and make sure breakfast happens and that you get to church somewhat on time. Or maybe if they're older kids and they kind of grumble and complain about having to wake up early on a Sunday morning or having to go to church. Whatever the case might be, I do want to encourage you in this effort of bringing your kids to Jesus. We as a church believe that you are the primary disciple maker for your children, and we want to support you in that, but we also want to come alongside of you in that. And so let me then speak to our whole church family. If we're made up of different families within our church, but we're all one church family, I want to encourage us as a family in what we've been doing to invest in children and youth. I mean, so many of you get up early on a Sunday morning to come teach our kids or our youth. Others of you come and serve in security so that there's a safe place for families to be and kids to be present. I want us to continue in this. I want us to be a church that has time for children and youth. I want us to be a church that doesn't see children and youth as a distraction from real ministry, but as the real ministry. That we would continue to provide places for them to grow. Safe places for them to be able to ask good questions and wrestle with doubts. Safe place for them to be able to come and learn about their faith. Also, not just for them to be able to grow as they sit and learn, but also as they use their gifts. I love to see, as Pastor Clark mentioned, our youth serving coffee in the foyer on Sunday mornings, or our youth up here leading in worship, or many of our youth serve in places where you may not see them as much, in the sound booth or with our children. But we want to continue to equip our children and our youth to grow and to use their gifts because they are important in what God is doing. But it's not just for the kids in our congregation. I think we should be intentionally discipling the kids of our congregation, of our church family, but we also need to make sure that we are reaching out to those outside of our church community. Whether you're doing that through maybe friendships, through neighbors, whether you're doing that through our partnership with John Muir Elementary, I do want the families and the kids of San Francisco to know that God loves them, that Jesus has time for them. I made a joke earlier, but some of you know that our city probably is not the most welcoming to kids. Kids aren't always seen as the priority, maybe often as a nuisance. I want the families of our city to know that in God's church, they are not a bother, they are not an obstacle, they are an opportunity. They are what God is doing. They are the people in whom He is working, and we want to invest in them. So let us continue to be a place that, as Jesus says, do not stop the children from coming. So parents, whole congregation, and then lastly, a brief word just to children and youth. If you are here this morning, know that maybe your parents put forth a lot of effort for you to be at church. Maybe our church has put forth a lot of effort for you to hopefully know God and walk with Him. But the choice is still up to you. That each one of us has to choose to enter as a child. Each one of us must come to God in such a way that we would recognize that we are totally dependent upon Him. See, that's why we're contrasted with these children to the next example. As Jesus takes the time to minister to these families and to these children, it says that He goes away, and there comes a man to Him. This man is the second case study. He's the second example of this upside-down kingdom. This man, we could say he came with an impressive resume, and he trusted in himself. So if you have one group that really came with nothing to offer, totally dependent, trusting in Jesus, you have here now another man who comes who really seems to be very impressive, very put together probably. But he also seems to be very much trusting in himself. Matthew tells us that this man is a young man, it seems. He's rich, we know that. He has a lot of possessions. But Luke tells us in this kind of same account of this story that he wasn't just rich, but that he was also a ruler. A lot of times people refer to him as the rich young ruler. And you kind of wonder, well, what was he a ruler over? Who was he ruling over? Well, most likely he was a synagogue ruler. Most likely, this was not just a wealthy man, but a very moral man. A man that probably had possessions and power, but also really good actions. Followed the law probably pretty carefully, and this is the way that he approaches Jesus. Notice how we see it in our text. It says, in verse 16, "Behold, a man came up to him, saying, 'Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life?'" Now, in some ways, this is probably not the worst question ever. I mean, he's asking Jesus not how do I get more stuff in this world? How do I move up? He's saying, how do I have this eternal life? But notice how I think his question shows us a little bit more about him. One, notice that he calls Jesus teacher. Usually throughout the Gospels, that's the author signifying to us or signaling to us that this person doesn't really trust that Jesus is the Messiah. Doesn't really believe that maybe Jesus is quite Lord. Maybe he's a teacher. He's got some good advice, some good counsel. It seems like this man probably thinks that he is on the right track, that he's probably really close to attaining his goal, and he could just use some advice on how to cross the finish line. That's how a lot of people probably approach Jesus in Christianity. Kind of thinking, well, I've kind of got things figured out, but I do need something else in my life to kind of give me some stability, some structure. Maybe they come to Jesus as a bit more of a teacher, a counselor who would be able to tell them, here's how you kind of shape things out in your life. Here's how you cross that finish line that you're so close to reaching. So he says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? There's something he believes that he can do, trusting in himself. And Jesus responds in verse 17 by saying, well, why do you ask me about what is good? There's only one who is good. If you would enter life, keep the commandments. Jesus' first question to him is about this idea of doing good deeds. Really probably the idea of being good enough. He says, what good deeds must I have to have eternal life? And so Jesus says, well, why are we talking about good when we know there's really only one who is good? I think Jesus is trying to hint at the answer early by letting him know, you seem to think really highly of your goodness, but don't you know the fact that actually none of us are good? There is only one who is good, and that is God. But Jesus begins to have this time of teaching with this man. So he says, well, if you want to have eternal life, if you want to be good, you have to keep the commandments. Well, in some ways, that's not a lie. It's true, God gave us commandments for us to be able to live like he wanted us to live. But if you just took Jesus' statement here, you might think that Jesus is saying, well, you can be saved if you just follow the rules close enough. You can be saved if you just really try hard and you are good enough. But that's not Jesus' point. Jesus is like a surgeon. He's the great physician. And right now, Jesus is beginning to take out his scalpel and begin to do some surgery on this man. And so he tells him, well, you have to keep the commandments. And so the man asks him, well, which ones? Probably thinking that there's some priority list. I mean, 600-something commands. I probably don't have to keep them all. Which ones are most important that would really make sure that I get eternal life? So Jesus names a few for him. And you'll notice that they all really have to do with what we might call the second half of the Ten Commandments. If you ever read the Ten Commandments, the first half really have to do with your relationship with God. The second half really have to do more with your relationship with others. So those are the ones Jesus points out first. He says, well, you're not going to murder, you're not going to commit adultery, you're going to love your neighbor as yourself. It's these commandments that are very focused on his relationship with others. The man says, well, good, I've done all those things. Now, this is probably not true, right? But I doubt that this man has actually loved his neighbor as himself. If he's as wealthy as it describes, has he really cared for those who are in need? But yet, instead of Jesus trying to just show him this error, kind of in maybe more of a symptom, Jesus goes to more of the root of the problem. See, I want you to notice what Jesus says next. And before we look there, I do want to make the point of what Mark tells us in his account of this passage. It says that Jesus looked at this man and that he loved him. Matthew doesn't include that little phrase for us, but Mark tells us that when Jesus says this to this man, it was out of love. It wasn't that Jesus was just annoyed. It wasn't that Jesus was just trying to prove this man wrong or show him how bad he was. It is out of love that Jesus says this. If you would be perfect, verse 21, go sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Come and follow me. It says, when the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. What has Jesus done here? Well, Jesus has really moved from that second half of the Ten Commandments really to the very first commandment. The very first commandment is that you are to have no other gods before the one true God. That you are to worship nothing or no one else besides the one true God. And Jesus has now gone to the heart of the issue. He recognizes that while this man may not have loved others around him, he maybe not has honored his parents in all the ways that he should, it's really all going back to a deeper root. And that root is that he loves something more than God. And what he does is he goes to the first commandment, but then he gets really personal. He points out, what is this thing in this man's life? Well, it was his wealth. It was his possessions. What God did he have before the one true God? What was he worshiping? What was he trusting in? It was all of his money. It was all of his possessions. And so Jesus brings him to the very first commandment, the heart of the issue, but he also gets really personal with him. You see, if you're going to enter into the kingdom, you have to allow Jesus to get personal with you. I have to confess, that's one of the hard things about preaching. There's enough of you in this room where it's really hard for me to get personal. Now, some of you I know pretty well, and maybe I could get personal, but I probably shouldn't do that in front of others. Some of you I don't know well enough that I could speak personally into your life. But the question is, are you going to allow the Holy Spirit to get personal with you? Are you going to allow Jesus to put his finger, to put his scalpel right on that infected area? You can allow the great physician to do his work by showing, what is it that you worship more than God? What is it that you trust in, that you're putting your hope in more than him? The reason he tells this young man he has to go and sell all that he has and give it to the poor, it's not because that's what every follower of Jesus has to do. But in some ways, that must be what every follower of Jesus must be willing to do. The problem wasn't the amount of money this man had. The problem was how much this money had this man. It was, what was the grip on his life? What was the idol that he had? And that's how Jesus has to be able to speak to us. You see, Jesus had to get really personal with this man because this man really thought that he was like at the point of the finish line. And he just needed a little bit of help to accomplish his goal. And Jesus is trying to help him to see, you're actually on the wrong path. You think you're getting really close, but you're really far away. It's out of love that Jesus would point this out in our lives if we'll let him. So this man leaves sorrowful because he loves these things. And Jesus turns to his disciples and he gives us these three truths about the upside down kingdom. Three kind of countercultural realities, understandings that we really need to make sure we grasp if we are going to enter in and live as people of the kingdom. So notice how he continues on. It says in verse 23, Jesus said to his disciples, truly I say to you, only with difficulty will a rich person enter the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus takes this example of this rich man and he says, you have to notice, it's going to be really hard for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, I think when Jesus is saying this, he's not trying to say, but if you're poor, it's really easy. In fact, he'll go on to say, all of these things are impossible for us. But I think what he is trying to push back on is the thought that people often had was that if you were wealthy, that meant you were blessed by God. So if you were wealthy or if you had a lot of things in this world, that must mean you were really good with God or you were really close to entering the kingdom. You see, here's the first kind of countercultural truth that Jesus is going to teach them. What the world often sees as blessings can actually be barriers. What the world often sees as blessings from God, and maybe they are, good things to be enjoyed, they can actually be barriers to our faith or to coming to the kingdom. That's our first truth that you'll notice there. Jesus is having to try to help his disciples understand that while they looked at a man, they thought, well, he's really religious probably pretty moral, has a lot of wealth and possessions. Those would seem to be really good things in this life. And it's true, not necessarily bad things, but Jesus is saying that actually the things that seem to be blessings can actually be barriers. The Bible's clear about wealth and possessions and money. I mean, we've seen it already throughout our study of Matthew's gospel. Jesus said you can't serve God and serve money. You can't have two masters. You're going to end up really loving one and actually hating the other. It seems to be because wealth and possessions are so important in our world, it's probably one of the leading competitors for our affections for God. So while we would see that the many things that we enjoy, the many things that we have are blessings, and in some ways they are, they're given to us by God, we don't recognize that they actually blind us to our need. There's a reason that in Scripture you rarely see the rich person or the self-righteous person coming to trust in Jesus. It's because they have trouble seeing that they really need him as a Savior. There's a reason it's usually the beggars and the lepers and the children who come to faith in Jesus because they see their need. They see the fact that they can't just help themselves. They can't pull themselves up by their bootstraps. They really need one to save them. But having so many blessings in this world can actually blind you to the fact that you aren't as close as you think. This is something we really have to be mindful of as people who live in such a wealthy place and time. I mean, almost every one of us here has more than the people of this culture would have ever dreamed of. A savings account, food in the fridge for the week, I mean, these are things that they couldn't even imagine. And we have to recognize that as many of these things are blessings and they are given to us by God, if we're not careful, they can be barriers. They can be blinders for us to not see our need, to think that we can trust in ourselves. But of course, it's not just that it's difficult for the rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. It's actually impossible. Jesus goes on to explain this. He gives them kind of an illustration. He says, again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, some people have thought that maybe the eye of a needle was like a gate, like a really narrow gate, and it was really tough for a camel to go through there, and that's what Jesus is talking about. But there's actually really no evidence of this. I think Jesus is doing just what we think he's doing. He's taking like the biggest animal that they could probably think of in their culture, a camel, and probably the smallest opening you could imagine, the eye of a needle, and he says this is what it is like for a rich person, anybody actually in this world, to try to get their way to God. His whole point is it's impossible. So the disciples heard this, they recognized this, and they were greatly astonished, and they said, who can be saved? Probably because they thought, well, here's an ideal candidate, a man who is rich, blessed by God, a synagogue ruler. This seems to be the ideal candidate for getting into the kingdom. But yet, he's just walked away. Jesus is saying it's impossible. Well, who then can be saved? And Jesus says, with man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. Here's the second upside-down truth that you need to know. Salvation is given by God, not earned by man. The second kind of upside-down reality of this kingdom is that salvation, eternal life, is given by God, not earned by man. The point isn't that it's impossible to get there, but you can get really close. I mean, think about it. How far do you think that camel is getting through the eye of a needle? Not at all. This is Jesus' whole point. He's saying, this is how far you are making it as you think that you can earn salvation. Comparing our goodness to others is like talking about who can come closer to jumping across the Grand Canyon. Maybe you could get another foot or a foot and a half than some people if you can jump really far, but none of you are coming anywhere close. Jesus' whole point is that for all people, no matter what good deeds they do, no matter how they've been blessed, salvation cannot be earned. You cannot prove your worthiness to me. You can't come to me with your checklist of saying, but I've done that, and I've loved my neighbor, and I've given this much, and I've done all these things, and this is why you should accept me. He says, with man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. Now, yes, that means all things. But notice what it means here. This isn't primarily talking about winning the big game, right? Or passing the test, or accomplishing something great. That's how this verse is often used. All things are possible. God can make it work. Well, it's true. God can do anything. But I think here he's talking about salvation. That while man cannot earn salvation, God can give it. And because he gives it freely, that means all can come into the kingdom. So with man it is impossible, meaning none can earn their way into the kingdom, but with God, all people can come into the kingdom. Because salvation is given by God, if you're thinking about it like jumping across the Grand Canyon, yes, if none of you are closer than the other, then none of us can ever reach it on our own. But it also means that none of us are really farther than the other. I mean, if the synagogue ruler isn't any closer than the tax collector, it also means that the worst sinner that you can imagine isn't any farther than you. That should give us hope. That should be good news. That the people who might seem farthest from God are actually well within his reach. The Bible says where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. If there's someone in your life you would think, I just don't think that person would ever come to God. I know what they believe. I know what they do. I don't think they would ever come to God. Then you don't believe that all things are possible. Or maybe you're here today and you think that that's you. Maybe you think I'm too far from God. Maybe you think I'm beyond his reach because of what you've done. The Bible says that that's a lie from the enemy. Because where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. Because salvation is given by God, it can be given to any that trust in Jesus. Now, next week, we're going to look even more about this concept of grace as Jesus fleshes it out in a parable about how amazing but also unsettling this grace is. But lastly, we come to our last truth. As Jesus is talking to this rich man about abandoning all, selling all, Peter says, well, that seems to be us. Verse 27, see, we have left everything and followed you. What then will we have? Now, maybe this is kind of a selfish question, but Jesus doesn't rebuke him, so maybe it's just a curious question. But maybe he's just trying to understand, we've done what you've just told this man to do. What does that mean for us? And so Jesus says, truly I say to you, in the new world, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you have followed me, will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or lands for my name's sake will receive 100-fold and will inherit eternal life. What is Jesus saying? Those who'd be willing to forsake that idol, those who'd be willing to surrender that thing that they trust in, they are going to receive something greater. Those who are willing to surrender all will receive abundant rewards. This is the last truth that I just want you to consider this morning. This kind of upside down thought that so many people think that you've got to make it happen for yourself. That you've got to look out for number one. That you've got to attain things for yourself. And Jesus says it's actually just the opposite. You need to deny yourself. Jesus says you need to die to yourself. This idea of you being in charge, dependent upon yourself. This is why you must come to him like a child. You must come totally trusting in him, dependent upon him. He is saying you've got to be willing to forsake that idol, that thing that you trust in more than anything, that thing that you love and worship. You've got to be willing to forsake it and know that if you do, I have something so much greater for you. Sometimes we shy away from these promises. It's like we often say, well, you just need to turn away from those idols because they're bad. Just follow Jesus because it's the right thing to do. Well, in some ways it's true, but Jesus is often giving his disciples promises of rewards. And I think it's a good thing for us to know that, if this rich ruler would have forsaken all his possessions, he would have received, Jesus says, 100-fold, more than he could have ever imagined as he has a relationship with God and eternity with him. Know that that is the same for you. That if you have to consider what you're going to leave behind in order to follow Jesus, as you think about that thing that he is calling you to forsake because it is an idol in your life, know that he has something even greater, abundant life here on earth, eternal life with him forever. There is something great to be found that when we realize when we have to surrender all, that he gives us more than we could have ever imagined. I've heard it said that Christianity, following Jesus, always costs you more than you thought, but it always rewards you more than you ever could have expected. That when we really come empty-handed, saying, I'm totally dependent upon Jesus, he will fill our hands up so much more than we could have ever done on our own. See, this is an upside-down kingdom. Forsake all to attain what you never could have had on your own. Jesus underscores this whole reality of the kingdom being backwards by saying in verse 30, and many who are first will be last, and the last first. Whole kingdom is backwards from what you expect, from the way that you judge things. This verse is actually an introduction to where we're going to be next week and a parable that Jesus tells in the beginning of Matthew chapter 20. But as we close this morning, I do just want to say, this passage does reveal to us how we are to enter the kingdom. Some of you this morning are here, and you need to enter the kingdom of God. The kingdom can belong to you, but it won't happen if you're trusting in the things that you've done. If you come to Jesus thinking that you contribute anything to your salvation, Jesus is going to try to tell you, you think you're close to the finish line, but you're actually on the wrong path. Would you allow this morning the good physician to speak to you really specifically? To point out that area in your life where you are trusting in something more than him. Would you see that he has something greater for you? Would you come to him in that childlike faith and enter the kingdom through trusting in him? Some of you need to do that today. Some of us, we live in the kingdom, but we need to live as people of the kingdom. We cannot continue to live in this world valuing things like the kingdoms of this world value them. We've got to begin living by kingdom values. We've got to begin following a king who lived in an upside-down way compared to our world. We can no longer pursue the things that the world just tells us are blessings. We've got to recognize the barriers that are there and being willing to surrender those things. We've got to recognize that we serve a king who came not to be served, but to serve. We have to follow his example as we live as people of the kingdom. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, God, for what truth is there to help us to see things that we would not see on our own. God, that on our own, these things seem so backwards and upside down, but as you reveal them to us, they come into the light. We come into the light of your truth, and it's made clear for us. God, I pray that as we see these things in your word, these truths, that people today for the first time would trust in Jesus, that they would allow him to be king of their life, that they would see the other things that they've been worshiping and trusting in, and that they would realize that those things will never give them the satisfaction, the reward. But God, in your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I pray that people would believe this and trust in this. God, I pray that those who are part of your kingdom, that you would continue to shape us to live as people of your kingdom. Help us to not see this world in the way that the world values it, but to be people who live according to the values of your kingdom. May we treat people the way that you would treat them. May we have time for people that maybe at times seem insignificant or a distraction. May we value the things that you value. May we live in a way that aligns with your kingdom. We know that we can only do this because of our King who has saved us from the kingdom of darkness, because of the Spirit who now lives inside of us. God, we ask that your Spirit would work in the hearts and lives of your people, that we might live as the people you created us to be. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We like to have a song of worship after the preaching of the word that just helps us consider and proclaim these truths. So would you stand and sing this song that aligns so well with what God is calling us to in his word? We can remain standing as we're about to be dismissed, but just know that that is our prayer, that you would be able to surrender all, whatever Jesus might be asking you to surrender, so that he might have your heart, so that you might walk with him. If you've got questions about what that looks like, or if you just want someone to be able to pray for you, just know that I'm going to be down front after our service. A couple of our deacons will be down front as well. If we could pray for you, if we could talk with you about what it looks like to follow Jesus, or just pray for anything that might be going on in your life, know that we're available. Or maybe you're looking to take that next step in your relationship with God, next step in getting involved in a church or finding a church home, belonging to a community. There's a next steps area in our foyer. If we could just help you take that next step as a church, we would love to do so. We think that's why we're here, is just to help people walk with God, to love and live for Jesus. And so if we could help you do that, we want to be able to do so. Or just know that if you're a first-time visitor, if this is your first time coming to worship with us at our church, we do have a welcome area in our foyer as well. We'd love for you to stop by there and just let us know that you're visiting, and just to be able to tell you more about our church and to be able to greet you a little bit more personally. We do have a meeting after this down in our fellowship hall, our annual members meeting. It's a great time for fellowship. There'll be food. We're going to have a chili cook-off. So we have a number of people in our church who have prepared chili for you. If you're a member, we'd love for you to come especially. But even if you're not a member and you would just like to come and appreciate the food and the fellowship, just know that you're welcome to come. As we eat lunch and enjoy the time of fellowship, we're also going to conduct the business of our church to be able to look forward to this next year and what God is doing, but also celebrate things that God has done over our and in our church over the past year. And so join us for that. I think it'll be a little bit different in terms of getting your lunch today. So as you go downstairs, you'll probably receive some instructions on how to do that. But we hope that you'll be able to join us. Isn't it great to see our youth helping lead us in worship? We do appreciate them and the opportunity that we have to be able to worship together. Most of all, we just want you to be able to respond, continue your attitude and your posture of worship even as we go from here. Always like for us to conclude our services by turning our attention and our affections to the triune God, that we would not put our affections in the things of this world or other idols that grip at our lives, but that we would give him our devotion and our love. And so would you sing the doxology with us?